We are going to learn about Power BI slicers. Slicers are filters. But wait, in Power BI, we have a visual called slicer and we have this filters pane. Filters pane is more for people who develop the report. Slicers are more for people who want to interact and use the report. So we are going to focus on the slicer part today. We are going to cover these topics. You can jump to a specific topic if you want. I'm using the April 2023 version of Power BI and I have enabled on object interaction. What is that? Have a look at this video. We need some sample data. I'm going to try this sample data set. Choose load sample data. Select the financials table and click load. That way we get data to work with. We have one table called financials with multiple fields. If you go to the data tab, you will see that there are 700 rows. So before we do anything else, let's first do some data shaping. We have country. Select the country column and go to data category and specify it as a country so it can become a map when you drag drop. The next thing is month name. Column tools, sort by column and choose month number. Nothing will seem to have changed here, but when you drag drop it in a visual, it'll sort it correctly. Month number is just used for sorting, so we don't need to see it in the report, so hide in report view. And finally, year is a number, but we never want to summarize it. Click on the year column and say summarization, do not summarize. You can download this file with the shaping done. The link is in the description. Let's start creating a report. Let's keep things simple so that we understand the concepts clearly. I'm going to create a visual of product and sales. I want to see the numbers, so I'm going to add data labels. You can add a slicer from Home tab, open Visuals dropdown and choose slicer. It'll ask you to add data. I'm going to choose month name and then arrange the slicer here. Increase the size so that there are no scroll bars. Other way of adding a slicer would be first choose the column, just drag drop and then change the visual type to slicer. By default, it looks like checkboxes. So if I click on August, look at the numbers. Everything gets filtered by that month. Although it looks like a checkbox, I can currently select only one at a time. If I click on the second one, the first one gets deselected. So this is slicer in its simplest form. You can control the way the slicer looks. If you have limited space, you use the drop-down option. When you open it, it is visible. You filter and close. How do you remove a slicer? Click on the eraser button, that is clears selection. The other option is tiles. This will automatically adjust based on the height and width, but this shows you individual things more like a button. Filter, remove filter, and then vertical list, which is the default. How do you change these? So let's start with the default slicer and understand how to change its style. I have enabled on object interaction. What does that mean? On right click, you have a format button and you don't have the standard formatting tab at all. If you want to see it anyway, you can go to view and format. Now, if I right click and format, it is going to give me the same thing. What we are interested in either way is slicer settings. And here you change the style. Default is vertical. You can choose style or you can choose drop down. That's all there is to it. This slicer is for text. But what if it was a number or date? So I'm going to change the field we are using. Instead of month name, which is text, I'm going to add unit sold, which is a number. And now, but it's scrolling too much and it's not very practically usable. So if it's a number with a long range, then a vertical list is not the ideal format. Now, of course, we can make it a drop down, but the drop down will also be inconvenient because we are still scrolling. And then what choice do we have? Tiles. Again, too many tiles is not a good option. Doesn't really help. So that's why for numbers, there's a very useful option called between. Now, what does it show? Minimum and maximum, which is a good addition. And I can just change the range. So let's say I want to look at items with low values. I just change the range to lower part of the spectrum. Or I want to see high value things. I just change it like this. It's very intuitive and convenient. We also have less than or equal to or greater than or equal to, in which case you will get only one of those items. So you can say greater than or equal to whatever number we choose. Now let's change this to a date. The moment you add a date field, we have a similar thing, but we have between, which is good. We can choose a starting and ending date and we get a calendar selection as well. Or you can just manually change this like we do for numbers. But for dates, there are some special types called relative date and relative time. Instead of explicitly specifying dates, very often we are saying, okay, what happened this month, last month, last year? So we have three things here. One is the relative period, last, next, this. How many of these and what? Days, weeks, months, and so on. So this is a very intuitive way of handling dates based filter. Let's see how to select items in a slicer. By default, we saw that in a vertical list, it looks like a checkbox, but I can only select one at a time. And that's because under the selection area, we have an option where multi-select can happen only with control key. So now if I press control and then click, multi-select is possible. But this is not a very intuitive thing and there's no indication that I have to press control. People get confused. So I would suggest that switch this option off. I click. Now I get a tick mark, which is much more intuitive. I click on one more. I still see a tick mark. So I can use any combination. And of course, clear selection is always there for us. Now sometimes, and I would say actually enable this all the time, keep the select all option. Why? The reason is sometimes I want to select all except something. So having that select all button is a good thing. Now, if you don't want multi-select at all, then you enable single select. First, I'll clear this single select. Now notice there is no scope of multi-select. Visually also, it looks like a radio button and everyone knows you can't expect more than one selection. Now let's see another type of slicer called hierarchy slicer. Let's add a new visual, choose the type slicer, go to the data, and this time I'm going to add segment and I'm going to add one more field, product. Now we can see the header segment, comma product. So these are the segments. When you click on a segment, it opens up and you will see the products. Now the products will be same under each segment. By default, it is multi-select with control. So if I select something, the other one will get unselected. Also notice that because there are two levels, this is selected, this is not selected, this is partially selected. The other thing you should know is about hierarchy, we have these levels. So you can actually have higher or lower level of indentation between main and sub hierarchy. And this icon may be non-intuitive. Notice down arrow means closed and up arrow means open. That's non-intuitive for me. So that's called a chevron. Instead, you can see plus minus, which is more intuitive, or a caret, which is similar, but this is probably more understandable by people. So use hierarchy when you want to filter in the context of not one, but multiple fields. One related thought is why have multiple levels of hierarchy and confuse people? Instead, why not have segment and product as two separate slices? Very good question. I'm going to go to the hierarchy slicer. Under channel partner, I'm going to choose Amarilla and look at this 0.32. Now I'll clear this. Now, if I wanted to do something equivalent here, I would have to go to channel partners and then click on this. So this is more intuitive, less effort. But of course, hierarchy should be used if in business context there is a hierarchy. If they are independent, then you should not use hierarchy. So here we have sales by product and month name as a filter. But let's do one variation. So month is not just a slicer. I also want to look at what happens on a monthly basis. I will put month and sales and that will give me another chart. I'm just going to convert it to bar chart. As expected, when I click on any slicer item, it will filter all other things. So this got filtered, this one only showing June. When I clear the filter, everything comes back to normal. Now if I click on the actual item in the bar chart for June, see what happens. The entire chart is still there. June is highlighted because that is the filter. And in the other visuals, by product in this case, it's still showing the overall picture for all products and it is showing the contribution of June. So highlighted is the portion dark blue, which is the contribution of June. Now, which one to use depends on the business requirement. Slicers are anyway occupying space, but just giving you a list, whereas visuals are not a list. They are showing data. Unless absolutely necessary, don't use slicer. Convert it to a visual and enrich the report. Right now, our report has one page. Now let's make a multi-page report. I'm going to copy the same visual and paste it on second page. Let's go to the first page and filter this on June. In which case, just remember first two, 4.4, 1.9. Now when I go to page two, nothing has happened here because the slicer on first page does not affect any other page. If you want a slicer to affect other pages, you have to do something extra. You have to go to the View tab and choose Sync Slicers. Choose the slicer, and now it's saying there are two pages. What do you want? Do you want the slicer to sync on second page as well? Okay. And now when I do that, it is exactly the same. In fact, first page and second page, the same slicer is shown and the visual is shown. You can even resize or reposition the slicer on the second page. Notice what happens here. In this case, on the second page, the slicer is visible and it is synchronized. Suppose I remove the visibility of the slicer. Notice it is still filtered on June 4.4. On page 2 also it is 4.4, but the slicer is not visible. So we save some space. So when is this useful? Maybe you have a first page where there are all kinds of slicers, and then rest of the report across pages it is affecting, so that it's easier to segregate the filtering from the visualizations. Now let's understand how filtering actually happens and how to customize it. These two are exactly the same visuals. This is a different visual. These are cards which are showing total sales. In this case, I have just changed this title to all sales, and here I have changed the title to all product sale. When I click on a slicer item, it's going to affect all of them. So now everything is filtered by September. We know that. Now I want to customize this, because all sales I don't want filter, and all product sales I don't want to respond to this slicer. So choose the slicer, format tab, edit interaction. Now you'll see a lot of confusing icons. So what is happening here? For each visual, we have one or more options. In this case, it's saying, should it be filtered by this or not? This one should be filtered, so I leave it alone. Currently it is in filter mode. This one I don't want to filter because it's all product sale, so I choose none. Same way, this should be filtered, this should be filtered. This one, all sales, should not be filtered, so I click on none. Now we have finished the settings. We want to get rid of the icons, so disable edit interaction. So edit interaction is a mode, it's on or off. And now you will see what happens when I click on September. Watch carefully what happens. This one changed, this one did not change, this one did not change. So that is how you can customize the filtering interaction. Finally, let's see how to use slicers for what if analysis. Let's understand the data first. I have simple transactional data, and I have a pivot table which shows card type and total amount. What I want to see is, if I had given discount, what would be the total amount? So it's what if analysis. I can potentially give discount between 0 to 5. So I created a separate table. In this table, there is only one column called PCT. It starts with 0 and ends with 5 with 0.1 increments. Now this table is not related to the transaction table at all. It's a completely independent table. So I want to use this table to show a slicer where people can choose any value, and then that should reflect in the total amount. So how do we go about doing it? First, I have put a simple slicer. This slicer, of course, contains the percent value. But in this slicer, what is the type? It is a single value slicer. Earlier we have seen between, but this one, I want one value. So we have a special case called single value. Now this is good, but in order to use this single value somewhere, I need to capture the currently selected single value. For that, I have to create a measure. So I've created a measure called percent value. What is it doing? A simple function gives me the currently selected value. If there's nothing selected, like right now, it'll give me empty or blank. Fair enough. Now, in order to get the what if analysis done, I have to use this percent value somewhere else. I have a measure called total amount, which is simple sum of amount. And now I want to see discount amount, where I will pick the percent value and find out the discount amount for the current total amount. That's simple. It's a simple percentage calculation. I'm using the divide function to avoid errors of div by zero or blank value. Divide takes a third parameter which says what will happen if there is an error. I will get it in zero. And finally, I have the discount amount. I have created another measure which says total amount minus discount amount. So now let's add discount amount and net amount here. Currently they are blank because we have not selected anything. Now let's see this slicer in action. I have also put the percent value so that you can see the selected value as a card. And now I can move this slider freely and I will get the calculation done, net amount, exactly the way I want. So this is an interactive what if analysis using a slicer. I am sure you will do all this, but before you go, there is another video you must watch, which is about on object interaction, which is like Excel. Insert visual, right click and format. Have a look at that. You will love it. So that's it for now. Thank you.